So welcome again for the second half. We did a switch. You saw Stefan in the beginning, and I have now the honor to, and I must compliment you, because I thought I'll start getting you in very early, but we're even 5 minutes ahead of schedule. Never happened before. We're building up tension, so before the big event at 4 o'clock. Looking forward, Ron?
Yeah, absolutely.
Good. But we have, again, 3 really brilliant, magnificent speakers. Yeah, I'll put the bar a bit higher so that you can live up to it. And the first I would like to introduce is Audrey Desjardins. And it's really very nice to see that Audrey, I mean, when you look at the speakers, you also see the passion and the friends and the colleagues that Ron gathered over the years. And I think one of the friends and one of the colleagues that you work already for a long time with is Audrey, because she started her master already at Simon Fraser on interaction design. You also did your PhD there, and the PhD was on designing living, experience the qualities of living in a prototype, and I think that some of the things you will show and tell today is about that. And Audrey will start working as of January at the University of Washington. So I hope you will still be working a lot together, but you have to miss her. And she will spread her wings. She focuses a lot on non-expert design, do-it-yourself, the maker culture, sustainability, IoT design, and it goes on and on and on. So simply, I would like to give you the floor. A warm welcome for Audrey.
Thank you. Can you hear me well? Hi. So I am Audrey, and I'll be talking about design and living today. So first of all, I just want to give you a really short introduction to what design and living is. And so very shortly, it's a vocabulary that describes the dynamic, reciprocal, and creative co-shaping of people, artifacts, and the space that they live in over a long period of time. And so I will today present 5 characteristics of design and living, but before I do that, I wanted to give you an example that I'm very passionate about. As Caroline said, it's a van. And this is a personal project that I've started 3 years ago. It started really as a personal idea of transforming this cargo van, an empty space, into a space that I could live in with my partner, Leandre. And so very quickly, though, this personal project became a research project. It became an autobiographical design project where I was starting to be able to understand how people, ourselves, would be living in that space and designing it as we would go about living in it. So it started with this empty space. And what the first thing we did is that we bought this little kitchen unit, we put our sofa in the back, and we went camping. We wanted to see what that space was like before we would make any decisions about how to design this interior. So, okay, we needed some insulation. It's still a car, it's pretty cold. We also needed some storage, and so we built that platform so that we could put some of our ski gear under and other elements. We also wanted to finish it with cedar panels because we have we're very fond of cabin in the woods. We're Canadians, by the way. This is kind of that level that we got at in the first year. And ski season arrived, and so we're like, okay, this is it. We're not building anymore. We're going to ski, and we're going to live in that space for a few weekends per month. And so we would put our sleeping bags in, and then it would kind of get a little bit messy. We'd use that little kitchen unit. And this was really kind of our first experience of living in what we had already built in that space. We started to understand the impact of what we had built. And we also started to appropriate some elements that we didn't know we were going to use. So we installed that little clothing line in the back and started to use some of these hooks and different kind of areas that we could attach things to in that space. So after that kind of first year in it, we decided that we wanted a little bit more comfort. And so we added these benches, which are also storage, and that table, which also converted into a bed. And as you see, that kitchen unit is still there. And so that was our first kind of sketch for what a kitchen could be. And it was meant to be there as a way for us to think about what our future design for that kitchen was going to be like. But we were still kind of unsure, and we kept it because it still worked. It still fit in that space. So, second year of skiing, we had some friends over, we continued to use it, and we continued again to use that little kitchen unit. And so, I flew in from Salt Lake at 2 days ago. I'm on a 2-month road trip. And so I am now really just living in that van before I start at University of Washington. And so the last addition that we've made for that trip was that we thought, well, maybe running water would be helpful. This is not fully running water, it's just a hand pump. But that already was kind of one more step towards more possibilities for us in the van. And what I think is important here is also to see how that kitchen unit, which we thought was just going to be a sketch, ended up staying because it really fit with what we were using. It fit with our competences too in terms of what we were building in that space. So, okay, I'm not really here to brag about this van, although I kind of am. but the goal is really to talk about design and living. And I use this example because it really highlights five of the important characteristics of design and living. So those five are, first, that it is an ongoing process, and it really is about this whole space transformation. Second, that it is about fit, but not only fit between elements in the van, but also fits between elements in the space and fit between all these things and us as people. So here is, we're really starting to talk about this co-shaping between the space and us. It's also about time and space. So, okay, big words here. But what I really mean here is that it needs time to happen, but we need to be within that space for it to happen as well. Fourth, it is about multiplicity, and I mean multiplicity of design practices. So as much as we did some really small tweaking as we were traveling, we also did those really big planned design moves when we were not traveling, when we were stationary. And it's also about resources, and here I mean that we are using the what we had already built as a step towards our next steps of building. And so we're kind of reusing and resourcing what we have already put into the van towards our next design ideas. So what I think is interesting now is to take this idea coming really from the van project, this idea of design and living, and think about how it also applies to other spaces that we live in. So I've been thinking a lot about how we live in the home. And so design and living to me in the home really touches on to the small changes and adaptations that happen every day. So how cups and plates continuously kind of rearrange in your cupboards based on the season, on who's there, on visitors, but it also is about the really major changes that might happen in a space that you live in, so home improvement is also there. And so here's a contrasting image. and why I talk about this my goal with design and living really is to highlight kind of the messiness and the ongoing process that we are in when we are living in our own lives and making the spaces we live in, and think about how this would also happen in a space like this, in a space in a smart home or in a space where we're talking about Internet of Things objects. And think, so oftentimes in these images, we kind of get just a snapshot in time. We think, okay, all these technologies are there, people are going to be using them, but it's oftentimes forgetting a little bit how this process is ongoing. And so that's why I'm trying to compare, or not to compare, but provide a contrasting image with design and living to that. So the other theoretical grounds. As Caroline said, I have studied with Ron for 6 years, and so although a lot of people are talking about different ways that people are engaging and using different artifacts and transforming those artifacts in their homes, my theoretical home is everyday design. and so in everyday design, we really talk about design and use. So this idea that design is continuing after an object leaves the hands of a professional designer. And it's about, again, a little bit what Yun talked about, having people not only be consumers of projects, but starting to be producers as well. And so what I really liked about design and use is this ongoing adaptation of artifacts. But what I really wanted to bring forward with design and living is that this not only happens at the scale of the object, but also happens at the scale of a space. Okay, so now I'll go into describing and with more details what each of these characteristics are. And to make this a little bit more challenging for myself, I decided that I would pick examples that are not the van to describe those, because I really want to show how this vocabulary can be applicable to things that are not the van. And so I've picked examples or cases that are either papers that have been presented in an HCI context. I've picked examples also from architecture practice. So, of course, there's a little bit of a disclaimer. It was really hard. I would have liked to find one interactive space that would represent design and living very well, but that was very hard. And that may be an indicator that actually maybe interactive spaces are not quite there yet. They're not yet implemented or created for people to engage in design and living in them. So I'll be using these examples kind of each of them as a way to highlight at the best of my capacity what each of these characteristics are. So I'll start with this ongoing process and the idea that it affects the whole space. So the paper that I chose to represent this quality is a paper by Tao Dong and all presented in 2014 at DIS, and it was called If These Walls Could Talk, Designing with Memories in Place. And so what this paper was discussing is how people understand the memories that are part of their houses. So either in the physical space itself or through photographs, but they were really there to kind of highlight what's the scale of time of the memories that are carried through in the space that they're living in. And so this example here is simply how, you know, if you remove the dishwasher in your kitchen, you might find that there is another kind of floor underneath your linoleum and a different color in the back, kind of all representing what was happening in that space prior to you living there. And so in their paper, they're trying to make a comparison between these memories or these traces in your house with how we today gather data about our houses and how this data of today might also be able to carry on for those decades or centuries over time. And so I think that this represents well this idea that the space is always transforming and that it's really an ongoing process, it's never finished. What's interesting here though is that because these are really focusing on these long-term elements, it's kind of ignoring a little bit the faster paced changes that are also happening at the same time within that space. The second aspect is fit. And here I really want to talk about how things fit together and this is used as a motivation for people to make those changes in their spaces. Their goal is to reach a good fit. Here's a paper by Andy Crabtree and Peter Tolmy. And so they've presented A Day in the Life of Things in the Home. And so that paper really focuses on groups of artifacts that have already reached a good fit in their homes. And so they have tried to categorize and kind of identify all the interactions that were happening in their homes with the artifacts over a full day. And so what they found is that small methodical assemblages of things are there to support everyday activities. So toothbrush, toothpaste, sink, water system, towel would all be kind of a group of things that would be used in the morning when getting ready for work. And so what they're showing, or they're using this reflection then to think about how we might be starting to design Internet of Things artifacts and what needs to be connected to other things. And so this really illustrates well how fit exists, but it doesn't really show how fit happens or how we get to that fit. And so that I come to that a little bit more with this third element, which is really the condition for design and living to happen. It's the idea that we need time and we need to be in the space for design and living to start to take place. And so the example I have here is an example where Charles Underwood is trying to site the house that he, or the log cabin that he's going to build in Alaska. And so this is a traditional practice in architecture where the architect will think about, with that site, where would it be the best to place this building? Depending on the sun orientation, depending on the soil, type of soil, drainage, vegetation. But here, instead of doing this on plans like architects do, Charles Underwood is an amateur, and so what he decides to do is to live for 4 months on that site in this camp with his family to decide what he's going to do and how he's going to live, how he's going to build that cabin to really fit this place that he has. And so this, I think, is a very striking example for how we can take the longest time and really decide where or how to design something. And so this, for him, really was kind of like the first period where before he would build it. But I think the van also shows that this continues to happen as you continue to live in a space and continue to transform it as well. The fourth aspect is about multiplicity of design practices. And in the van project, we really showed how two amateur designers were really kind of using different strategies to create their space. But here I want to also highlight that this also can happen through with multiple designers. And so Casa Yasmina is an apartment, but also kind of a gallery and a little bit of a lab as well that's connected to the headquarters of Arduino in Torino, Italy. And so what they did with that space is that they invite people to come and live there. And when they come and live there, they're expected to add something to that space. There's a lot of different tools around, different prototype materials that are accessible. And so designers come in with their own preference for materials, their own skills as well, and they continuously add to that space. And so that's another way of showing how different design strategies are used within one common space that keeps on growing here. And the last aspect is about resources and using either the artifacts in this space as a resource for design ideas or design actions, but also the space itself. And the idea that I wanted to present here is called Light Bodies. It's a project presented by Suzanne Seitinger and all, and presented at TEI in 2010. And so what this project was is that these little lights, they're actually just a light in a little soap box. And they're portable, they're easy to carry around. And so the lights are reactive to sound and vibrations. And so with these artifacts, then you can completely transform the lightscape of a space. And so they've been used in VJ presentations, for example. They've been used in this art performance as well. And so this idea here is that artifacts can make an impact also to the space that you're living in. These, of course, are not necessarily a lived-in space, but this kind of illustrates this idea anyways. So these are the 5 points. And so now I want to take a little bit of a step back and think a little bit about what this means if we're thinking about designing interactive spaces. And so there's 2 points that I want to talk about. The first one is about connections, and the second one is about change and unfinishedness. So I'm really excited that Yun was presenting about the Non-Finito project earlier on. So I'll start with connections. And so I think that with the idea of design and living, we really started to see how things need to fit together, how things need to coexist and live in the same space, the objects and the people. And when we think about Internet of Things, we're really proposing that most artifacts will be able to be connected and will be able to be networked. And this is the world that we'll be kind of living in. And so what I want to propose here is that maybe a lot of these artifacts will be digital, but I'm pretty sure that a lot of artifacts will still be non-digital. And so I'm kind of wondering how those connections will happen between the digital and the non-digital things. And so the example that I had was the alarm system, and it's funny that you presented the fridge with the sensor magnet, because that's the same thing with an alarm system, right? There is the system and the computational aspect to it, but then there's also, it's kind of connected to something that wasn't computational beforehand, and you're adding this new functionality to it to kind of surveil it, we could say that. And so that's just opening a question for me, and what are going to be those future relationships between digital objects and non-digital objects. Another aspect that I wanted to talk about with connections is, beyond those material objects that we have, what other kinds of connections can we have, or what kind of relationship are we going to have with things that don't have a physical presence? So the Amazon Echo really is just a small object that represents a bigger thing, which is this conversational agent that people can have, you know, ask questions, have information from. And so the question here is, with this object really kind of as a placemaker or it's just there to kind of present what the object or what the intelligence is, what space do we have for design and living in that case? What kind of transformations will be able to happen in that case? So the second one is about change and unfinishedness. And this is really central to design and living. It's really this idea that it's ongoing and it's going to never be finished. And so the first thing that I wanted to talk about here was this scale of time in change. And so this also relates to what Will was talking about, how we need to also be considering kind of these longer periods of time in the spaces that we live in. And so what's interesting for me here is thinking about how these connected artifacts, for example, in the Internet of Things, would have their physical presence, but also have the service associated to them. And so these two things might not change at the same rate, and there's not room for the everyday designer to access both of them at the same level. And so I'm wondering what kind of change is going to, or what kind of transformations are going to be possible for these artifacts. And then the last one is about unfinishedness. And Yun talked about three different ways in the non-finito project, non-finito paper, in which we can leave things unfinished. But I think that what design and living really proposes too is to think about how we might leave things unfinished in between things, in between elements within that space that people are living in, for people to really continue to add and to make those links themselves in between artifacts. So to conclude, design and living is this dynamic, reciprocal, creative co-shaping of people, artifacts, and the space that they live in over time. So thank you very much.
Beta Paul and I are really amazed because we're looking at the stopwatch and exactly at 20 minutes. 00, we were finished. I think it would be best if we do the three sessions in a row, because I personally liked it very much when the discussion started. So I would like to invite the next speaker, if you can already maybe set up. The beautiful thing, of course, is another, I would say, friend of you, Erik Stolterman. I don't know if I have to introduce him to do. I think he's well known in the community. He's a professor of informatics and the chair of it, the informatics at the Umeå University of Bloomington. He's also a professor at the Institute of Design at Umeå in Sweden. And you know what was weird, but that is my lack of knowledge, of course. I met you first and remembered you first from the United States, and I wasn't even aware that you were Swedish, which is kind of stupid from my end. You're co-editor-in-chief of the ACM Interactions, of course, that you've collaborated with Ron intensely, a lot of editorships on design thinking, on books for MIT. And I think the beauty is that also when you wrote me an email is that you said you have this 25-year-long quest about interactivity and what interactivity is. And I truly hope that in the next 20 minutes you will feel a bit of your quest over the last 25 years, but you have at least the audience that will be really intrigued to hear anything and everything about interactivity. The floor is to you, Erik Stolterman.
Okay, thanks. Thank you very much. It's great to be here. Congratulations, Ron. It's because of you we're here, so it's an honor to be here today and to be invited to this occasion. And it's been a great morning listening to all these great people talking. And yes, that's exactly what I'm going to try to do, as you can see. This is what I'm trying. A report on ongoing investigation of interactivity, interaction, and interface. And together with Lars-Erik Jarnlett, that's very important to mention because he's my collaborator all this time. It says 25 years there. It's actually, I realized it's more than that. We started out as PhD students together. Yeah. Long time ago. This is why are we doing this? Why do we need to look into what is interactivity? Isn't it obvious? Don't we already know that? Doesn't everybody know that? Well, in a way. But one question, why is this? We have these wonderful interactivity opportunities everywhere today, and we all use it everywhere, and all the time maybe, even some of you right now. I don't know. You should look here. And this is wonderful. I mean, it's great. We can do things that we could never even imagine just 20 years or even less 50 years ago. We connect to any place in the world, any person in the world at any time, and we can do all this amazing thing and interact with our fridge or whatever. But there is this other part of it, and that is this overwhelming everyday experience of interactivity, that it is, maybe it's too much. Maybe people get stressed. They complain, connected all the time, interacting, or why do I have to interact with everything? Why can't things just be things? And all that. And then the question we have been discussing for many, many years is, okay, so it seems like people agree on that interactivity is increasing. And then the question is, what is it? What is it that is increasing? And how do you define it? And how can you even measure it? If people seem to know what it is, and they are sure it's increasing, well, how do we measure it? And so that's what has been our starting point, and we've worked on this for many years. So how do you find that out? Well, you can do it in different ways. You can do it, as you can see, traditional different types of scientific work, trying to see what is it that people experience as overwhelming? What is that overwhelming feeling of interactivity? And a lot of people do that. And the second one, I think, as we've seen today here, several examples of, which is design early investigations into this, where you actually build stuff and design things, partly with the purpose maybe to create interesting things, but maybe even more with an ambition to actually understand something better, and understanding maybe this notion of interactivity or the experience of interactivity. Or you can do it in a different way, and this is what we have tried. So we have tried to understand interactivity better by developing definitions, basically. Yeah. And that, I know people get very excited when you say that. Oh, wow, cool. Yeah. Definitions, cool. So we have done that by, we have tried all the time to stay very close to some kind of everyday intuitive understanding of interactivity, not coming up with these very fancy ways of thinking about it, but really staying close to when you ask people what is interactivity, they give you an explanation. We want this work to stay close to that, so it has a relevance to some kind of everyday understanding. And this is something you have to say all the time. This is a complement, not an alternative explanation of interactivity in relation to contextual, situational, experiential, blah, 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 blah. It's a complement, it's not an alternative. So how did we do it? Well, the method is we basically been thinking, discussing, and writing all this time. We have worked with examples and definitions. And I would argue it's primarily the very traditional philosophical method of investigating things. Peter Paul can hopefully say that that's true. We'll see. What we've also done is we've been very artifact-centered. So we really focus on things. When I say things here, it's in a very abstract meaning. But we focused on the things. We don't focus on the people. And we focus on things that and the design purpose. So for instance, you want to investigate the glass, you can investigate it with a design purpose, and the design purpose is probably to hold liquid and to drink. I mean, that's kind of what we understand is the design purpose, because you can use it in so many different ways. I can throw it on Ron if I want to. It was not necessarily designed for that. You can investigate that purpose too, and you do that if you apply some of these other more traditional scientific studies on people's behavior and how they feel about things, yes, of course, but that's not really what we've done. We looked at the design purpose. We also looked at this design oriented, so we're looking at these things and only the aspects that are in the control of a designer, not things that designer can't control, okay? Not saying more about that. Some other considerations, and this is where it starts to get difficult for some people. We don't care about users. We have not cared about user experience at all. We don't care about what's good and bad. We don't care about what's easy or what's difficult. We're not trying in any way to find solutions or prescriptions to a better way of doing things. We try to move closer, which means we lose the big picture. We try to really move closer and closer to be able to say something very specific, which means everything else becomes a big blur. We don't try to sweep in. It's not when someone says, but isn't interactivity also about this? We say, maybe, but no. We don't want to sweep that in. We don't want to sweep that in or sweep that in. We try to do the opposite. Sweep everything out. I don't know if that makes sense. So, this has been difficult. I can tell you to do this, to follow this approach is very difficult. I'm not saying this because we truly believe this is the best way of doing this or investigating interactivity. This is the way we chose to do it. So this is one possible way to do it. To follow this was extremely difficult. To not care about users or user experience, to not care about things like good or bad, oh man, you have to really concentrate when you do these kind of studies, because you fall into that trap all the time, because your minds go there. It's always, but how does this work? What do people think about it? No, step away, all right. So we've done this for a long time, as I said, and this is what we came up with. This is actually a book right now that is going to be sent to the publisher next week. So it's very new. The book is new, not the ideas, but the book. So what we came up with is an interface thought style theory, and that is a big thing. We build that on Ludwig Fleck's idea about thought styles. That was a precursor to what's the paradigm shift guy? Kuhn, Thomas Kuhn, which kind of describes how we've understood interface over time. Different ways of thinking about interface as boundaries, as control, as different things. I'm not going to talk about that now. We came up with a pretty ambitious, I would say, theory of interaction elements. Hey, that's a lot of stuff. We come up with a new definition of the interface. I will talk a little bit about that. We come up, as a consequence of this, you have to do a lot of other things. So a lot of other things just emerged in this process, like these other concepts, expressive, impressive, character of thing, faceless, interactive, interactivity, etc. We also came up with, so now if you say that these things, and what we talk about, we say that interactivity, or we created two new words, interactability and interactiveness. Interactability is the ability of an object or a system to be interactive. Interactiveness is the power by which an artifact or a system persuade a user to interact. So, but it's all on the thing side, it's not on the user side, okay. If we start to make these claims, now someone can say, well, now can you measure this? Can we now measure if it's more or less interactivity? And we say, Yeah, sure. Here are some ideas on how you can do that. They are still very rough and probably not useful, which is, again, goes back to this. They are not useful, but you can, all right? When we had done this, we also realized that just by looking at these ways of explaining what interactivity is, we can also start to speculate, because now you can see there will be consequences of this, which is not speculations in the sense guesses about the future. It's more like you take the situation and you just look at where does it go. And you get to this point when you can start to make, I would argue, quite serious speculations about where we can see the future of interactivity. Again, we're not saying it's the good or bad, we're just trying to develop that picture. So that you see, now I'm going to go through each of these in detail. Mm. No, I'm going to talk about these. I just picked a few things because it was a little bit too much to do. So I will talk about faceless interaction, interactivity clutter, and interactivity fields. Because I think it relates to the theme and the topic of here of everyday and everyday experience of interactivity. It means you don't get the whole definition stuff. So, okay. So one thing that we did, we decided that interface, we need a definition of interface, and we couldn't really find any good one. So we took the simplest possible and said that interface is a surface. That means it's face, it's a face, so it's a surface. If you say that interface is a surface, you also realize a lot of interactions goes on without an interface. Because there's a lot of interactivity in the world, there is no surface. So if you make that very strict definition, things start to fall out. So for instance, you can start to make this distinction between surface-bound modalities and surface-free modalities. And I don't think I have to explain that in any detail. You kind of understand that. So we understand, for instance, you can do gestures. And we all know that. We do today, the best place to see this happen is if you go to a restroom. And you can see people live in the surface-free modality world when they are trying to find out how to turn on the water, because there is no surface, there is no interface, and they're waving and they're trying every kind of, you know, how do I get the water on and how do I turn it off and all that. So that we are used to this. We're used to have this interface-free or surface-free, or as we call it, faceless interaction. You can have weak sense of faceless interaction or a strong sense of faceless interaction. Weak sense is when it goes one way only. So for instance, if you use a Kinect and you gesture, probably the reaction or the consequences of your gestures are shown to you on the screen. So you have an interface that shows you, gives you input, if you want to use that language. But you communicate through gestures. You communicate surface-free, but the system connects to you via surface. That's the weak sense. We call that the weak sense, because it's very common today. We have just one way. Then you can have the strong sense of faceless, which is when it's no way. So you can argue that Audrey's example with the Amazon Echo, if you put it behind a curtain, now it's a complete faceless interaction. So you just talk into thin air and you hope that someone hears you and you get the response. And you just get it with voice, so there is no surface, you don't know. It's just this magic and that happens. Usually when you walk down the street and you happen to open a store door, and it scares you because suddenly it just opens and you realize, did I do that? Was it me? Was someone else? Is you also have this completely surface-free, or in the strong sense. Okay, so that's not new, but we think it's a very good idea to make this distinction and start to make those definitions, because you can start to handle and discuss different situations in different ways, because it cuts through interactivity landscape in a different way, in a little bit new way, and it helps us to separate things, I think. makes it possible to examine more precisely different forms of interactive technologies, where we sometimes say, well, that's pretty new or cool or interesting. What do we mean? Well, does it have to do with this interactivity aspect or not? What it also leads to is these new interactive environments. So that's the next thing I want to talk about, what we call interactive fields. So when you have this faceless world, and you walk into a room and you don't know, can I turn on the light by just walking into the room? Do I have to do something? Should I say something? Feels silly, but I can try. Or should I do this? You do this and suddenly you lock the door. I mean, you don't really know. So this thing is something that we start to see happening. It's not just with facelessness, but when we have faceless interaction, this really increases. Because we get to this point where these fields are made up by all entities that belong to an environment, plus all the entities that people bring in and out of the environment. So the interactivity field here, why we use the notion of field, because it's much more interesting. There, you can't talk about surface, because if you talk about surface, you have these very dedicated surfaces that you interact with. When you don't have that, what is it that you live in? Well, we think field is a good metaphor for that, because fields, you kind of move through fields and you can interact with fields. You don't really know where and when and how to do it, but you're quite sure it happens all the time. So for instance, in many cases, we know we're probably in this field. Maybe we are surveyed by a camera somewhere. So I'm interacting with someone. I don't know it. I don't know where. I don't know how. Maybe it goes on. Fields are fluid. They change over time. They do not stay necessarily put. They are very difficult to define. Entities are added and removed without any consideration how they or their interaction will fit or work together. This is something that Audrey also mentioned. So when you came into this room, you brought all these devices and things. And they start to interact with everything else, maybe. We don't know. Again, maybe. And the field changes. You can see this kind of change in the field. And now it's a different field. There are no locational direction of a well-defined, well-delimited source of target. There are no interfaces necessarily in a field. So unfortunately, I have a little text on this slide because I like this definition. It helps a little bit. So perhaps a new thought style, and this is the word we use. It's now forming as we speak, a thought style with an ecological, contextual, or ambient character. In such an interactive environment, users are immersed in an ecology in which they are not conceived as interacting with particular targeted objects one at a time, but rather are moving in situational and interactional force fields, causing minor or major perturbations in their environment by their moves and actions, while being guided, buffed, seduced, or affected in any which way by constant movements and changes in their environment taken as a whole. I like that definition. I think that kind of describes the situation where we're not necessarily right now. In some, I think we have places where this is almost already full-blown in existence with these fields, but in most places we're not there, but we're moving. So that's interesting. I just want to add a little bit about this clutter notion, because when you enter into the field, you get into this world of interactivity clutter, which is very simple. Too many things are going on and you don't really know. And we define it in two ways, perceptual clutter and behavioral clutter. And perceptual clutter is when things are in the way for each other, so you can't see and you don't really know what's behind something. We've had that for a long time on our laptops and computer screens, where windows are covering other windows. So we can't really interact with things because they are in the way and the screen feels cluttered in some way. Then the behavioral clutter is this when you do something, you do a gesture and you want to turn on the water, but you turn off the light. And it feels like you're in this clutter of interactivity and you can't really control it. And you don't really know how to control it. And this is something that we are starting to see. And this is probably one of the consequences that leads to this thing I started with, which is people feel overwhelmed. Because when we live in a world of clutter, when we live in a world of fields, people get overwhelmed because you are not in control. It doesn't feel like you have control of your things. You can move them around and decide what they do and what they should do. You can't, because it's this force field. And if you move something, something else happens, and you've made something else possible. Yeah, so there are a lot of questions around that, of course, that we can discuss. Or who is responsible for the fields? Can they be regulated? How do you design for these fields? Who knows? I mean, this, I have no idea. We have no answers. So what we've learned from this is, what we learned here is more back now to this approach. You know, I've told you about the approach, no user, blah, blah, blah. I think this has been very efficient in a way. It's an efficient approach. Apparently it takes a long time, but it's efficient in revealing aspects of HCI that otherwise are difficult, because if you do this, by narrowing down the focus and kind of neglecting aspects, what you do is you get an opportunity to, in a very detailed way, really start to build something from the ground up. And I think that has shown that it's possible to do. It's also obvious there is still a lot to be done. The cool thing, I think, is a lot of this is kind of theoretical, I would argue. But since we follow that principle of staying close to people's everyday experience of interactivity, it's still extremely relevant from a practical point of view. At least, I argue that. Yeah. So, that's it. Hopefully this book will be out maybe in the spring. I don't know when, but it's called Things That Keep Us Busy, The Elements of Interaction. And all this is there, not just this last thing. All that list of stuff is in there. So it's a lot. That's it. Thank you.
Then we move on to... you had all kind of questions. Oh, no, it's your laptop.
It's her computer.
We move on to the last speaker before we will have the discussion. The last speaker is Peter Paul Verbeek. Peter Paul is professor of philosophy. Sorry, at difficult word of technology at the Department of Philosophy at the University of Twente. You sent a very nice CV to Ron that he gave me 1 minute before I kind of checked your website. What I found interesting, and I skipped actually your vice dean role, but you apparently, you found it important enough to send it to him. So he is vice dean of the Faculty of Behavioral Management and Social Sciences. What I actually picked out is because I like that a lot, that you're co-director of the design lab.
That's much more important.
For us it is. I don't even start with the number of chairs, committees, and everything you're doing. I actually know you as this passionate, full drive, fast forward professor that's doing so much interesting time and actually bridging between philosophy and design, that you inspire not only us at DQI and in the Department of Industrial Design, you inspire Ron a lot, and you will hear how his talk will be influenced by your theories later on in this afternoon. And I actually hope, and I'm really happy that you found the time to be here today. And I really hope that you inspire us, but design beyond the human. Peter Paul Verbeek.
Thanks a lot. And it's really not only that I hope to inspire you, actually I get inspired a lot by you. I cannot say how happy I am to be here after you, Eric, because I think really the way in which you expressed your quest sounds so phenomenological to me. It's really what I like to do as well, to let things speak, to think from things, and to explore what it means to take things seriously in the social world. That's quite a challenge. And I hope to explore a new type of things robots, which of course are things that you might work on a lot more than I do, but I'm starting to discover them as an interesting boundary case to study human-technology relations. Because of course they are technologies, but on the other hand, they are supposed to look like humans as well. They seem to be, well, exactly because they are boundary cases, they raise a lot of questions about human-technology interactions. And of course, there's always a lot of talk when robots are designed about anthropomorphization. Should they look like humans? And what does it mean that they start to look like humans ever more? At least in popular discourse, I think they do look like humans. And people are even really worried that they will somehow outdate us, right? That robots will enter the social world and that there will be technological unemployment, that robots will do healthcare, will do teaching. Robots will take over the role that humans have in society. So what I want to do is to address that issue from the perspective of that theory of mediation that we are working on in Twente, in our department, which is a theory which tries to analyze human-technology relations in terms of media. Not seeing technology as objects over there and human subjects are in here, but technologies are always shaping relations between humans and the world. And that's what they do and what we need to understand. So I will first explore a bit that notion of robots as somehow replacing humans. How could they do that? How should we see that? Then try to see if we can expand that idea towards the idea of mediation, bringing some notions in also from Hegel, the master-slave dialectics, which is often mentioned actually when it is about robots, which I hope to give a mediation twist, and then see what that could imply for ideas about interaction. So let's first speak a bit about robots replacing humans. Maybe some of you have seen this movie, Ex Machina. A really good movie, I think. A very interesting movie, which is about some kind of a second version of the Turing test. The Turing test is designed to see if a computer can act like a human, right? The computer is in another room, the investigator is over here, and if the investigator cannot tell anymore if he or she is interacting with a human or a computer, the computer has passed the Turing test. So in this movie, there's actually a second version of the Turing test. That lady thing in the middle is a computer, of course, an artificially intelligent being designed by the guy over there on the right, a very rich guy, the owner of Blue Book, which is a big software company that took over the world. Everything goes through Blue Book. And he hires the guy on the left, an employee, to interact with that lady thing in the middle for a whole week. And the Turing test that we have now is, of course, different because he sees that she is not human, but she will pass the test if, after a few days of interaction, he actually starts interacting with her as if she is a human. And he does, I can tell you. It's becoming some kind of a Frankenstein story. Her name is Eva. I think that's for a good reason. She is the new Eve, the advent of a new species, you could say, and she also wants to extinct the old species, I think. So this is, I think, a guiding image. We are designing technologies that ask for specific kinds of interactions that seem to outdate ourselves. Also, in a lot of discourse around more mundane robots, like drones, we have that. They take the place of the postman. They bring the parcels from Amazon to homes, at least that's what Amazon hopes, and the postman could find an underpaid job at the warehouse of Amazon rather than taking the post to us. Military stuff, of course, is much more nasty to speak about, but also there, the fear of people is actually that technologies will start doing the stuff that humans used to do. Also here in a comic, where Obama tells a drone, and now make sure that you never hit civilians, but only targets in the military. So this is, of course, becoming quite nasty. If technologies are starting to make choices about life and death that only humans are supposed to do, how could we design them possibly? Ethicists are trying to build in all kinds of ethical algorithms into self-driving cars that need to make a decision whether they will kill an elderly woman who somehow crosses the road or the three kids that are sitting on the back seat. How can we let robots do what humans do? Robots are supposed to take over. They take our jobs. Maybe they are there already. Is this the right way of looking at robots, I ask myself? Is this how we should think of them? Should we design them as quasi-humans? And should we indeed be afraid that they take over? Or do we need a different frame? Maybe a completely different account from design, which is always a better place to look, I think, is this account, the frog robot, designed at our university You see him here actually with the king and with one of his designers, Daphne Karaman. Frog is a robot that guides people through musea, etc. And one of the main outcomes of this research actually was that a robot should not look like humans. As soon as they start to look too much like a human, people don't feel really nice when they interact with the robot. So the art is to make them look a bit like a human, to mimic social interaction, but also to let people feel that this is not a human. It's interesting. Apparently, the humanness of the entity itself is at stake in designing the robot. So how can mediation theory help here? Well, maybe it's good to start with a Twente story. Twente, where I work, used to be a region of the textile factories, which was, of course, a region where the machines took over the work of humans for quite some time. One of the main themes also, of course, of Marxism, and the idea that devices will take our jobs. Ultimately, I think what happened was not that the machines took over the work of the humans, which was the fear that people had. We thought we made the perfect slave, and then suddenly humans became the slaves of the machines, right? But that is what happened. This is how people ended up there, not being replaced by the robots of those days, but by being degraded, as it were. This was the only work left for the humans, the stupid work of somehow cleaning the machines, relinking the two threads when there was something broken, etc. That was the only thing. It was a mediation. Well, that brings us, of course, to dialectics, Marxism. And one of the most famous analyses, I think, of Hegel, taken up by Marx, is that idea of the master-slave dialectics. You see that with robots as well. We're trying to design the best slaves there are, right? And we don't need to feel guilty because they are not really human, but they can act like a human. From Hegel, I think you can learn that there is an interesting interconnection between masters and slaves in the sense that a master can only be a master if the slave is there as well, if the slave somehow allows him to be a master. And the way in which the slave is a slave decides how the master can be a master. There cannot be a master without a slave. So the master is as dependent on the slave as the slave is on the master. What's more, the master somehow makes the slave into a specific slave, but the slave also makes the master into a specific master. And I think that's an interesting opening towards the idea of mediation. Interacting with a robot is not just using a robot and being afraid that ultimately it can be so good at things that it can do all the things that humans were doing. Maybe we should ask ourselves, how do robots change the practices that we are engaged in? Not, will robots do the teaching? Will robots do the nursing? Will robots do the policing? Will robots do warfare? But how does warfare change when there are robots involved? How does teaching change? How does nursing change? What do they do? How do we interact with them? And then, of course, mediation theory comes in, with that basic idea that if you understand technology is as media between humans and the world, there's always this dimension of human perception, experience on the one hand, and human action practices on the other hand. Technologies, when they are used, they establish specific kinds of relations between humans and the world. For a robot, of course, that's quite an interesting thing. Of course, you can say, well, we interact with a robot and the world behind the robot is not that interesting. But in fact, what happens is that the robot has some kind of a connection to the world behind it, to the patients, if it's a nursing robot, to the pupils in the classroom, if it's a teaching robot, to victims, if it is a military drone. And we interact through the robot also, of course, with the world which the robot is interacting. And we start interacting with that world in a different way when interacting with the robot. If I have enough time at the end, I would like to explore that notion a bit more deeply, maybe also a bit very philosophically, with Merleau-Ponty's idea, which enable, I think, us to think about interpersonal relations in a what deeper way than what we have been doing until now, with the notion of the flesh. His basic idea is that humans are made out of the same stuff as the world. It's a bit different because we have experiences, and not all the stuff in the world experiences as well. But we can understand what it means to perceive something because we are made of the same stuff that can be perceived by others. There's some kind of reciprocity between us and the world around us. And he calls that the flesh. That means when you interact with another person, it's not just you versus her or him. It's actually you as the toucher, but also as the one who can be touched, as a seer, but also as the one who can be seen. And the other person has that same thing too. It's not a line, it's a cross. It's some kind of a chiasm. So that's what we could explore to understand how robots mediate that interaction. So if you think more closely about how robots mediate, there are at least three elements to take into account. a bit technically, but maybe it can help to understand a bit better how we can move beyond the idea of replacement. There's an interaction with the robot, an interaction of the robot with the world, and then of us with the world through the whole robot. So for teaching, for instance, and you see a teaching robot actually in the classroom of one of my own kids, Anna Vanessa Evers, who's on the right, her son is also in the picture on the left. Of course, she is doing some experiments with this type of robots at the school of our kids. And you can think, okay, the fear now is that the robots will take over the teaching, but what is happening is actually that the robot is changing the way in which teaching takes place over there. Where kids learn things from the robot, but also have to teach things to the robot in order to understand better what they should learn, in fact. So what happens here, I think, is that there's this encounter between the child and the robot, with a new kind of social interaction, and they like it, they think it's funny to interact with the robot. The robot also has an interaction with the stuff that it needs to teach. And then ultimately, it changes also the role of the teacher in the classroom, which, who gets a new role, a new kind of responsibility, maybe also being a new kind of role model. The child gets a new way of understanding the material because the robot teaches it in a specific way, and kids deal also with each other in a different way through the robot. A lot of things change that you can investigate and design if you think like this about a robot. It becomes a bit more tricky, so to say, if it's about drones. Typically, we like to think about drones as unmanned aircrafts, right? We think the humans away, they're unmanned, and that's what makes them a bit scary. But of course, they are not unmanned. We just need to think the human back in. There's always an operator somehow, if you have a small one. And also if you have a military one, a bigger one, somebody operating the drone, somebody actually being present in the world through a drone. I think a drone is quite an obvious example if you look at it from that perspective of mediation. And a very complicated one at that, because a drone operator actually operates an operating unit that operates the robotic body of the drone. And those two elements shape the relation of the operator and the world, the soldier, and the victim, the policeman observing a neighborhood, the fire brigade observing if a fire is really extinguished. So what you have here is actually an interesting thing, that there is a composite relation, as it were, between humans and the world, where there is this second body at place, and also where we see the world from above, which gives us a completely different orientation on the normal world, you would say. And also an asymmetry, because of the robotic body, the observer cannot be seen itself. What the observed person sees is that robotic body that cannot look back at the observer. It also has implications for people who are being observed. If there is some kind of a political manifestation or a pop festival and there are drones above it to see if everything is okay or nothing goes wrong, the robots, the drones, form some kind of a background relation which have a lot of implications for how people could behave. If Erdogan is seeing what's happening in some kind of political demonstration with this type of drones, of course it normalizes, it has a lot of implications for how you could even be a democracy. Public space changes. So this is how you could think mediation into robots. Of course, for robotic action, it might be even a bit more nasty, because then obviously also you speak a lot more about robots in warfare. But you also have that same idea, an operator interacts with how a drone interacts with a victim. With, as an extra addition, the operator has this relation with the control unit that together have a relation through the drone with the victim. Also here you could say it's not a replacement of the soldier. Actually what you see, what you hear a lot in the media, is that the soldiers who are doing this suffer from a lot of nasty feelings after having been in such a situation. New forms of PTSS that are more severe and harder to treat than we have known so far, which comes from that kind of double presence that they have. So they can really look their victims straight into the eyes before they kill them. They have been observing them maybe for weeks. They get integrated in their lives. It's completely asymmetrical. And they look around themselves and they have a nice sip of Coke and eat a hamburger and they go on with their lives. And they cannot deal with that. So that's interesting. There is this composite agency, the robotic body, again installing a first-person view for the killer, but a third-person view for the victim, a new way of being engaged with the world. A heavy example. But how can we understand that then in terms of interaction? The last part. Do I still have 5 minutes or so? Yeah? Good. I was hoping that. So, I think maybe the most interesting thing then to think about when you address how robots ask for specific types of interaction is more about how robots allow us to be there at a specific place in the world with this extra body. It's a form of telepresence, you could say. And we perceive and we act on a distance with the same combination. And so there is a distance, and what kind of distance? How does that distance take shape? How does the robot, the drone, mediate the distance? But also the presence. How are we there? How close are we at the same time? It reminds me a lot, actually, of what we've seen in an interesting analysis by Jos de Mul, a very interesting Dutch philosopher of technology, who was thinking about eccentricity, polyeccentricity even, when thinking about the virtual world. Eccentricity is the phenomenon that human beings are not just in the world, but they also know that they're in the world. And so we can see ourselves being somewhere, right? We have a double relation to the world. We are a body, but we also have the body. If you're in a virtual world, you could say, well, we also have then this virtual body, and we can look ourselves over the shoulder, but we can also look our avatar over the shoulder. So there's two eccentricities at the same time, you could say. The implication of this, I think, in the real world, not in a virtual world, is that you could think of robots, drones, as also giving us extra bodies. So it's polyeccentricity only, but also from polycorporality. The drone operators, the robot operators, have this second robotic body operating in the world, having specific kind of perceptions, interpretations, engagements that we need to understand. And I think there Merleau-Ponty comes in nicely. A French phenomenologist, actually, whose work has played a lot of role in the early days of post-phenomenology mediation thinking, because the whole idea there is that humans should be understood as bodily beings, have engagements with things, with the world, and actually are being constituted as a subject through their bodies. He also calls it the body subject. So what kind of subject is then shaped or constituted when you have this extra body? I think there this notion of chiasm comes in very interestingly. As I explained a bit already, it's about some form of reciprocity. We can only understand that we are able to touch something, to perceive something, if we know what we are touching, what we are perceiving. And that's actually made of the same stuff that we are. It's material. We are stuff as well. Flesh is what he calls that. The vivid word, you could say. That also has a lot of implications for understanding interpersonal relations. As I said, touching implies also the possibility to be touched, and meeting somebody means also understanding what it means to be met. So we are made of what we encounter. And that brings up an interesting question regarding robots. Can there be something like robot flesh, or what do robots do to the flesh of the world? So maybe to zoom in a bit more on that chiasm thing. In phenomenology, it's actually almost always, you could say, dyadic relation. It's human world mediated through a technology. It's a line. And now suddenly it becomes a cross, where the technology mediates the cross. So it mediates how touching and being touched have a relation to itself. How we understand what it means to be touched, and how we understand what it means to touch, to see or to be seen, to meet and to be met, to be a subject or to be an object, to be a self or an other. And that might be actually a very interesting thing to explore further in human-robot interaction. And this is maybe exactly what is the issue in the bad experience of soldiers killing people through a robot body, right? What happens there is, I think, that the flesh there, as Merleau-Ponty says, always has some kind of a thickness. We are close to the things that we see because we are made out of the same stuff. But there's also a distance because of that flesh. We are not the same thing at the same time. We see it. He calls that the thickness of the flesh. And I think if you interact with the world through a robot, the thickness has several layers, right? It's of course, the flesh of the operator. It's the flesh of the controller he's operating or she is operating. It's the robotic body. Those three elements constitute the nearness and the distance to a victim. Well, the entire reciprocity is somehow distorted. Maybe we can learn to reintegrate it. We have often learned that actually when using new technologies. But here, the main thing is the robot body can touch but cannot be touched. The operator body can touch via the controller but not be touched. And the robot can be seen but the operator body cannot be seen, and the operator sees via the controller what the robot body sees. So there's all these layers between that distort the whole reciprocity. So, what does it have to do then with interaction design? I think, of course, the example is quite heavy. I'm normally a bit more cheerful, I think, in my talks. But it's so interesting, I think, because there's a lot at stake and because it shows the many complexities when you try to understand the interactions between human beings. And that notion of the flesh actually could open a completely new dimension to understand mediation. If we want to read the robot mediations, I think there are three things at least to take into account on the basis of what I just said. And we can understand the intentionalities of the robot. How do robots give us an intentional relation with the world? How do they link us to other people? Robots form backgrounds and they condition our lives like a political demonstration does, the life in the classroom, etc. And we encounter a robot and we learn something about what it means to be human by interacting with a robot that looks like a human but is not a human. And that could also mean that maybe the notion of flesh could be inspiring when designing a robot, because the flesh will then mediate that whole cross, as it were, between us and the other, between self and other, but also between seeing and being seen, touching and being touched, etc. Maybe that can help a bit. At least I hope it contributes a bit to further understanding of what interaction could be in interaction design. Thank you.
So if I can invite you three, Audrey, Erik, and Peter Paul, and I will already thank Ron for letting me chair this session. Quite a challenge. Maybe I'll do a startup and you can already start crushing your mind how you want to challenge these gentlemen and women. In the previous session, it went very much about materiality, openness, unfinishedness, etc. And in a way, you could also couple that to your three talks in a different way. But I'm kind of intrigued, coming from your mediation technology and having the human technology world relationships, in how you actually see that openness, what the influence would be on the way we are trained as designers. And we have a lot of designers and design researchers in the area. And where in the beginning Oscar was, I don't know where Oscar is sitting, but he was also responding in one of the later questions that he said, like, what can I do as a designer? When do I stop? What is the openness that I give? And it was basically in all your three talks, like, you give a lot of openness to the people. You talked already before that you said, well, what if it gets really complex? And now seeing all these, your talks, you also see where the complexity is going. So what if the materiality is something else? You're talking about time, you're talking about space, you're talking about development, etc. But also very much the role of the designer in there. Erik, you didn't dare to touch the question at some point, if this clutter, how to answer it, what is good, what is bad? And then we dive completely into the ethics, like if we have robot flesh and something else. So does it also mean that responsibility of the designer, where we had things at the home in the beginning and now we're basically scaling up to interactive spaces, to things and time and environment and to robots and drones that even are further away. What would be the influence for designers to train? What can they still design that openness?
Are you asking me now or all of us?
Will you
take the mic? You are looking at me.
Yeah,
Okay. And actually, I do not even see such a big tension, not at all, actually, between Eric's attempt to refrain from doing ethics and the ethical implications that my talk could have. Because actually, I've not been trying to do ethics. Actually, I've only been trying to get so close to how those things have an impact that the ethical dimension pops up. But I wouldn't have an easy answer to how to deal with it, right? For me, it's also a way to get close to that. And I think this is really how we could train the designers, because developing sensibilities for how things play roles in society, in human lives, and how their functionality always installs relations between humans and their environment, and
that's, I think, the central thing in interaction design, obviously, but also in order to play your role in society in some kind of responsible way.
Is it then that we should reflect in the process, discuss a lot, work together with philosophers, etc., to really question things, get definition, get theory?
Yeah, I think we should, but I think we should also incorporate it in our methods, in our methodology as designers, right? So part of designing means trying to get in touch with the world in which the design will take a place, and you can do that actually in quite systematic ways, but it also means obviously to get in touch with the world for which you are designing. It's not something you can just do behind your desk. No.
So I would say, as an answer to that question, that I'm not sure I understood completely, but that what the three of us talked about is something that I'm trying to argue for today, and that is designers needs, maybe they need a little bit more of systems thinking. Because if you look at these three, what we all talked about were basically systems. I mean, Audrey talked about the system of the home and how it connects to everything else. So whatever you do, it connects to a system. And I think we both talked about systems. And the complexity of the systems, it's obvious, I think, that is increasing. And I don't think we need to measure that. I think the complexity of the systems are increasing. So to be a designer is getting more and more difficult. And to find a way to design something that fits into a complexity in a way that makes sense is difficult. And you can open it up. I mean, that was the solution of Will and Yun and in the morning, that if you open things up, maybe the argument is that then things can better, it's a higher chance that they can be fitted into this complexity of things. But systems, yes, I think designers need to think more about systems and will be forced to.
So what I wanted to add, I think, is kind of a methodological place for a designer. And so I think I like that both of you really are using thinking and argumenting to create definitions and ideas. But to me, to really kind of think about what designers can do, I had to go back to making, and that comes back to what Oscar was saying. And that's why I think I was so, it helped me to be in that van and to create that space to really understand the impacts of what I was making. So I think that one of the ways that designers can really take to understand the implications of what they make is to really live with them. That's kind of one of the conclusions I had from my project, yeah.
I think I'll open up the questions to the floor. Anyone has some questions for one of the three, all of the three? Jelle.
Yeah, it was mainly a question for Peter Paul. So I'm wondering if you think about robots, especially drones, as sort of telepresent things, then I'm extending my body and I can operate maybe very close to you while I'm still sitting here. If you think about robots as being other people, then I'm interacting as if I'm the operator, I'm no longer just the operator, I'm interacting socially with another subject, right? Do you think that it's either or for artifacts that we can create, or is it like a slowly shift, like a continuous line? Because I do think it would be difficult, if you get down to the details, to think about how it could be continuous. Yeah. Because what is in between then?
Yeah. Many things come to mind when I need to answer the question. Well, let me first say, seeing a robot as a subject, that's a really a bridge too far for me. Because that would imply so many things, that would really imply that the distinction between humans and robots would vanish. I think that's not the case, actually. But you see some kind of a move of the humans and the robots towards each other, right? We put ever more technology in the humans, and we have become cyborgs, and we put ever more humanity in the technologies, social robots, etc. So, I mean, you can ask yourself, is there a point where the two can meet? But subjectivity, having your own intentions, having the possibility to be held accountable, etc., to be creative, innovative, I think that's not very close yet. seeing the relation with the drone as an extension of yourself is also a complicated thought for me, because I would say extension sounds like it's some kind of a neutral add-on, right? And so it's your intention, but you extend it through the robot. But that makes the robot or the drone too neutral. It's a mediator, so it's not just an extension of yourself, it changes yourself. That's the master-slave dialectics. The slave changes the master. I become a different person when I use a drone. And seeing a robot as a mediator of a practice would imply that you don't see a nursing robot that distributes medication in the hospital as a subject, but as an element in the practice of care, where a nurse with the robot cares for people and changes the roles of the nurse and changes the trust that people have in the nurse, etc. I think for now, for the kind of robots we have now, that will be more important than having fantasies about subjects as robots. Maybe that's the best thing to conclude. We have always been cyborgs.
Ron, I'll bring you the mic.
So I had the real pleasure of asking you a question that one of you asked this morning of the panelists. I think it was Eric. I can't remember now. But I think that it was this idea, well, you know, are you just hiving off a small part, this narrow element, and looking at that? Reduce this continuity between, is there really the, can you reduce it down to this continuity between operator and drone? Can you really, I mean, you had an incredible list of stuff you were not doing and you were not including in interactivity. And Audrey was hiding in a van. So, and this is about every day. So it's actually what I want to add, my question is about, is these everyday matters, is all of this, is it all really just too much? I mean, on some level, it's like, I mean, I think you want to do empirical philosophy. So I guess that's my question. Is it too much? And some people say it's everything, or it's impossible.
Yes.
Okay, I want more, Eric.
No, I totally agree. I mean, I think the every day means everything. I don't know what actually is outside every day. Because isn't that what we live every day? We live our lives every day. So it is really everything. So of course it's too much. But I think there is a difference you can make. And I think what we have all here done today in different, very different ways, we're trying to cut through that every day, the extremely complex experience of living every day in different ways. And whatever cut you make, you leave out a lot of things. And you just have to accept that. There is no way, I think, of thinking that the everyday experience with technology, whatever, can be brought down to something small. I don't think that. I think it's something that can be reflected on in many different ways, with different kind of lenses and perspectives, but you cannot do the wholeness. The richness is too much. It's just too much. So you have to make your cuts.
So I think that's very true. I agree with you. And I think that that's why the van example was so powerful for me, because it's this 10x6x6 area, that space, that then I was really able to focus into the details of that one thing. And so it's this precision, I think, that helps you then get to the definitions and the explanations.
It would be boring if I would say that I would agree too, so maybe maybe I can try to disagree a bit. I mean, it is a lot. Yeah. Trying to scare me off, eh? It is a lot, but I think we need to engage with the everyday, obviously, in order to take responsibility as designers. So that's actually why I started with the idea that I want to choose boundary cases. And in this case, I think the social robots are also boundary cases, in the sense that, I mean, they are coming, they are there.
And we should not have the fantasy that we can somehow fully anticipate what will happen once they are there, but we can try to stand at the boundary of what we can understand now. And then seeing that suddenly they somehow problematize specific dimensions of interpersonal relations, causing new forms of PTSS in soldiers. Again, not a cheerful example, but an example that can teach us something. And then suddenly seeing, okay, what's at stake is actually much more than just a human-robot world relation. It's the character of interpersonal relations, the chiasm that we have never seen that suddenly pops up, right? So I think the everyday can come into play at the boundary examples where we feel that the everyday might start to change when it starts to feel uncomfortable.
So yeah, so just to follow up on, so I was kind of looking for an answer kind of like that, which was, I was like, because bringing it back, I mean, such precision, you cut out so much, and then the question especially here comes, well, how does this apply to designers? And now you've had this sharp, very specific, such a degree of specificity that now to pivot, and we're not talking about reductionism, this is not this at all, and to pivot and say how does this apply is a bit of a challenge. But one of the things I think that came out is each of you has different framing strategies. And I think you just elaborated on yours. And I think that, can that, we used to talk about this as problem setting in design, which now seems very quaint compared to what we're talking about. So I wonder if you could talk about the sort of, perhaps is there something transferable from the way your approach is to what we could generally speak as design issues and translate it as framing, possible framing approaches for designers. Maybe I'm coming up with an answer. It's really meant to be a question. Yeah? I'm done.
maybe you get an answer.
Maybe I'll get
it. Well, I think one thing is that, it's a good question. I mean, some of these things you can't really do, but I think the idea that each approach or each way of framing or whatever we would call that can bring something to the table. And I think as a designer, it's just extremely important to understand what are the possible approaches or framings that you can use to understand things. For instance, I think the way I've been working on this wouldn't necessarily make sense in relation to how Audrey worked with her if I was a designer who was supposed to work on everyday living, for instance. I think then her approach to develop your repertoire and your designerly sensibility, then that approach is probably much more efficient. To do that, though, it might be that doing some other type of framing, maybe philosophical framing or whatever I did, can give you new ideas that you don't get necessarily by just be in a situation. I think this notion of, I just mentioned that notion of the interactivity fields, I think it's going to stick in some of your heads. And when you design something, you may even have that in the back of your head, and suddenly the field idea will may help you to think about potential future situations, maybe in a van. So I think they complement, again, they complement each other. And as a designer, I think you should be, again, this is just, we're pushing more and more pressures on designers. First of all, everything is systems, and then everything, you also need to understand all the possible approaches that you can take. It's terrible.
I'll go after.
I think I like a lot what you said, but maybe to add a bit to this, I think you should also see the relation then between design practice and theory as some kind of you could say reciprocity or something, that they also shape each other and inspire each other. And so I think there's also really the style of doing philosophy of technology that I like. I think in the old days you would have the philosophical tradition and you would read it and look at the technologies and you apply the theory to the technology. Now it's the other way around, right? You study technologies and you see how they challenge existing framework and you try to update them, to expand them, to think new things. But you do that, of course, on the basis of a tradition that can bring in concepts and ideas that can also inspire design practices. So it's like looking in each other's mirror, and then it becomes really deep.
So I think what's hard, too, is when once you take a framing position, and so that's, for example, that's what I did with the autobiographical design project. You go full in, I've lived in that van for 3 years, on and off, and then you get really, really good at that frame or at that position. But then when what I tried to do in the talk was kind of take a step back and pivot and try to see, well, how can I take what I've learned from that space and see how it applies to something else and find other examples that fit. But then that was really hard because I knew that one example so well. And so I think that's one strategy that I think I will try to use again late, you know, in my career, which is take a position, go all the way with that position, but then try to change and see what happens when you take that same idea and with the new position.
We have time for a very last burning question, a very short one if someone is still, because Ron at some point also has to prepare, because you see him already jumping on the chair a bit. Has to do all this stuff in the upcoming. No one with a jumping question, burning question. Then I would like to get again an applause for the three speakers, Audrey, Erik, and Peter Bolt.